largest market for Nokia globally. Shiv has over 2 decades of experience, bulk of his experience in marketing and general management, handled more than 34 brands in his career. He spent many years at the Sun Lever and then moved on to Philips, the general electronics, where he was on the Philips board. And since 2006, he is with Nokia. He is also on the Goddard board. He writes, teaches, and is an avid sport watcher. He is married to Hamsani, who runs her own brand in innovation consulting. And I'm sure most of you know, she is an IIMC alumnus.
If you look at the size of the market in India, the size of the market in India is going to be pretty big. It's going to be of the order of $637 billion in the next 6 years. That's a very big market. So the total retail market is that big. In India, currently we have 12 million retail outlets. Too many. Winston Churchill in 1945 said, India is a nation of shopkeepers. Absolutely true. We have too many outlets. To give you a rough number, America, which has 23 times our GDP, has 1 million outlets. Has 1 million outlets. We have 1 by 23 of their GDP, but we have 12 million outlets. There's a reason for that. And the reason is, getting into distribution in India does not require any education, does not require any capital, does not require any space, does not require a license. That's why people have seen distribution as an employment opportunity in this country. That's the reason we have many, many of these outlets. Now go back to what I said. Very little education, very little space, very little money. When people have very little money and very little space, what do they rely on? Velocity. They buy in the morning, sell by the evening, pay you tomorrow. So velocity is the determinant factor in Indian distribution. Professor Ramcharan, who taught me many years later at a general analyst course, writes about this in his book, Execution, that velocity is key. So any book you read from Professor Ramcharan will tell you why velocity is key. And velocity is very, very well practiced by the Indian retail trade. Even if you give them 10% margin, Indian trade cannot digest it. They vomit 9%, keep 1%, rely on the rest. The new investment required by 2007 is of the order of $30 billion. That's the reason why you see people like Walmart wanting to invest in India. That's the reason the American government, the French government, are talking to the Indian government to say, please open up FDI for the retail sector. It's big game. That's the reason. The total number of people employed is about 21 million. A typical shop can be 100 square feet. I have seen many shops which are 2 square feet. What I call a hole in the wall. That's what it is. There are many of them. So you walk down from our institute, Jokhard, right down to TKTK, and you can clearly see those hole-in-the-wall outlets. Lots of them. Number of operating malls, 114 as of a few years ago. Now that's multiplying. That's multiplying like mad. And new malls under construction, 3 times that. That's what it is. So big, big opportunity. That's the point I'd like to make. Next slide. If you look at what's really driving it, not a surprise, food and beverage is a big one. 74% of the total Indian retail market is accounted for by food and beverage. Not a surprise at all. Why is that? 53% of a rural person's income is spent on food. 45% of an urban income is spent on food. So it's not a surprise that food dominates. And even in the biggest of supermarkets, in the biggest of countries, food is dominant. If you go to Marks and Spencer's in London, you'll find that the food aisle is key driver. Even in countries where spend on food is less than 10% of the total disposable income, food is very important for retail. Very, very important. Of course, then you have apparel. Apparel is big. If you speak to Kishore Biyani, who's the head of the Future Group and the Big Bazaar Group, one of his ambitions is to sell jeans like mobile phones. So every time I meet him, he says, Shiv, you guys are selling millions of mobile phones. How do I sell jeans like that? How do I transform this country so that everybody wears a pair of jeans? So apparel is very, very big in this country. Right. Next slide. The other thing you should look at right now, when you think of distribution, is what's happening in urban India, what's happening in rural India. And I've given you a few categories in terms of what the penetration is. If you look at car at the top, urban penetration is 12, rural is 3. Given the state of our roads, we'd argue it's too many already, right? Motorcycles, urban 34, rural 19. Color television, urban 54, rural 17. Mixer grinder, 56 urban, 19 rural. Ceiling fan, 89-48. Wristwatch, 88-76. Bicycle, 53-69. Pressure cooker, 80-38. Toothpaste, 75-38. Shampoo, 52-32. Both these categories I worked on. utensils 1615, toilets of 1989, washing powder 1985. Why am I showing this chart? Can you draw any inference from this chart? Anyone? When you look at this chart, why do you think I'm putting up this chart? Anything? What strikes your mind? What comes to your mind when you see this chart?
The items
shown,
the rural market is not well connected, so you are looking
in
the future to target rural market
in some big chunk
of.
Okay, that's one. So there's headroom for growth in rural India and some categories, correct? Any other observation?
The penetration is comparable.
Penetration is comparable. Very good point. That's the second one. Any other observation before we move forward?
With rising incomes, the penetration levels in the high-tech products can be increased further.
Correct. Yeah, quite less. Valid observation. Third. Next, any other observation? Okay, so let's take your observation. Okay. Let's stick with that. What is the implication of your observation? When you say penetration levels are roughly similar and are fairly high, what is the implication of that? To a marketeer or to distribution? Okay, let's go back. Let's walk back. If you have a category which is under-penetrated, you penetrate it. What do you mean by penetration? You get somebody to use it. You get somebody to use it by giving him a motivating argument. Please come into mobility because you can stay connected with your loved ones. Please use deodorant so that you don't have body odor. Please use toothpaste so that you don't have bad breath. That's a motivating argument. That's how you get people. When you finish penetration, when you finish that, what do you need to do after that?
Reach.
Correct. Resell to the same customer, that's for consumption. How do you get people who wash their hair once a week to wash their hair three times a week? How do you get somebody who wears a tie only for a special occasion to wear a tie every day? How do you get somebody who brushes his teeth in the morning to also brush his teeth in the evening? That's the consumption matter. Penetration in India can be defined in many, many different ways. For example, in some categories, it could be ever used in the last 1 month. Is that a good definition for cigarettes? Maybe no. Ever used in the last 24 hours. So, the definition of penetration can be from 1 day to 6 months to a year. If you look at something like araldite, the penetration of araldite can be very high because somebody buys it, it's in their house, nobody uses it. So penetration simply has the person's body. What's more important in today's economy is consumption. How do you get people to buy more? Have you drunk coffee? Almost certainly yes. Do you drink 3 cups of coffee a day? Almost certainly no. So the battle now is in the consumption era here and not in the penetration era. People such as myself grew up in the penetration era. So what did we do? Every single thing, we made it into a sachet. We put it the right price point on it, whether it's 1 rupee, 2 rupees, 5 rupees. We distributed it through wholesale, made it available to more and more people. That was the penetration era. The consumption era is exactly the opposite thinking, which is what your generation will do. How do you excite consumers with concepts? How do you get the sensory appeal of the product or the category you're talking about? Okay, those are the ones that become important. Equally, from a distribution and retail point of view, how do you get salespeople to educate people to use that category more? That will become important. Earlier, you were just selling a price packet and getting people into the category for penetration. Now, you really need to tell people why this will change their lives. What will it be better? That's why when you go to a supermarket, you see, for example, the L'Oreal beauty person. Every woman in this country will give her right arm to get L'Oreal cosmetics. Why? The person there on the floor really does a great job of selling L'Oreal to her. It's not about penetration anymore, it's about consumption. And that's the shift which is happening. So that shift is happening in India dramatically. Today, India has a $1 trillion plus GDP. It will double in the next 8 years. And 66% of that will come through consumption. So you as marketeers, when you think of distribution, when you think of categories, think consumption now, not penetration. My generation thought of penetration, it's over. Your generation needs to think consumption across a broad parameter of categories. In some categories, there's still a headroom for growth. So that's the point I want to make. Next chart. I mentioned that distribution is the sum total of activities from a producer to the consumer. So let's start. That's the producer, that's the consumer. Now, if I'm a producer, there are many ways I can reach the consumer. The first and most important is I can reach the consumer directly. I can go directly to the consumer and offer my products or whatever I'm selling. Can you give me an example of that?
Vireka Folks
is a very good example. Absolutely right. What else?
Tupperware
is another example of that. Perfect. So Eureka Folks, Tupperware. So what these people do is they have armies of gents and gentlemen and gentlewomen, and they call you up, they come, they do parties or whatever it is, like Tupperware parties, they come and sell you. That's what it is. So direct. That's one model. Second model. Fantastic. Post. Who does the post? Two famous examples of people who do the post. Somebody can give me both, I'll give you a Nokia phone. Two celebrated examples is one. The second one is the more difficult. Not two. The guys who pioneered it. Two people. Reader size is absolutely bang on correct.
Manorama?
No.
Habitat English?
No.
Sears?
No. It's a tough one. Okay. That's why I offered the mobile phone. Okay. The two guys who pioneered this, one was Reader's Digest, the other was Bullwalker. These are the two guys who, you know, did the post service and made it very successful. Bullwalker. These are the two guys. Now, there are a host of people who do this. Most magazines do this. Most magazines in this country follow the post structure. So you look at The Economist, you look at Business Today, you look at Business India, you subscribe to it, they give you a discount, it reaches your doorstep. The post. The third is, there's a producer, he sells to a middleman, or the middleman collects from the producer, and the middleman comes and delivers it at your doorstep. Can you give me examples of that? Correct. Newspaper is one. Think along the newspaper pattern. What are the others? Milk is another. Absolutely right. Think along the milk paradigm. What is the next one? Eggs is another. Next one. Vegetables. What's common to all of them?
Vegetables.
Absolutely right. So think concept now. Perishable. That's what happens. So when you have a perishable product, how do you reach it to the consumer? That's one way. At the door of the consumer. If you deliver a newspaper to somebody after 9 a.m., does it work? Maybe in IIM Calcutta, right? Definitely not in the open market. So you need to deliver a newspaper before 6 o'clock. You need to deliver the milk by 6:30. You need to deliver the vegetables by 7 o'clock. If it doesn't work, you're gone. So there's a time dimension to a distribution model. And that's the best explanation. Third, next. The producer has his own outlet. The consumer goes to the outlet. Now if you see, the arrow reverses. The consumer is going to the outlet. Give me examples of that.
Automobiles.
Automobiles is one. Most famous out of Calcutta. Most famous out of Calcutta.
Food.
You guys are a new generation. Bata. Bata, pioneered, big one. Okay, so the producer has his own outlet. Either he runs it himself, or he has franchised it out to somebody, and people go to that outlet and buy those goods and services from there. The catch of this is inventory. When you run your own outlet, you are saddled with inventory. And managing that is a huge problem. I don't remember my data now. There was a point of time, when I taught your class, 2003 or 2004, I knew this data. If Bata had 100 rupees turnover, their inventory was 25 rupees. They had 25 rupees inventory stuck up. And that's always a challenge. So when you run your own outlets, when you run your own chain, what you need to measure is inventory. Why do you need to measure inventory? Because you make your money through inventory turns. If you are having 1/4 of your annual turnover in inventory, that's 3 months. So how many turns are you getting? Four turns. Disaster. So that's why you need to measure. So that's the concept I want you to think about in distribution, inventory turns. The inventory turns here is 360. Okay, that's ideal. Okay, but you don't get to 360 every day to get it with traditional products. Fourth, You are a producer, you have a brand, you cannot set up your own distribution, you give it away to somebody else who does the distribution for you. Can you give me examples of houses who do distribution? Third party houses who do distribution? In a way, right? The two big examples for this were TDK,
Voltas.
TDK is to be the distributor for many a product. Many a product. TDK started by distributing bonds.
The 1800s.
So Voltas has built Amul, it's built Rasna and all those brands. So they are a distribution house who take on other brands and run it. Not a very successful model in India. And we'll come back to it later on as to why. And the last one is the most commonly used distribution model in India, where you have a producer, he has a clearing and forwarding agent called a CNFA, who then sells to a redistribution stockist, who then sells to trades from where the consumers buy. This is the most dominant model in India, which is the FMCG model. Clear? So these are the different ways a producer can go to the consumer. Next chart. Some concepts now. This is in terms of strategy and thinking about distribution. We call it the three A's. Availability, accessibility, and affordability. They are all linked. The example I'll give you for availability is tea versus coffee. In the 1940s, there was a period of time when the coffee consumption in this country was more than the tea consumption. However, the tea growth was higher than coffee growth. So what Lipton and Brookbond did at that point of time was very simple. They employed thousands of salespeople to go and sell tea into every single nook and corner in this country. In 1965, between Brookbond and Lipton, they had 6,000 salesmen. 6,000 on their company rolls. So what did these 6,000 salesmen do at that point of time in maybe 250 districts? They went to every district, every hamlet, sold tea to 40 shops or 2 outlets. Because it was cheap, affordable, over about 15 years, tea became the bigger drink than coffee. That's what happened in India. Coffee is still the premium drink, but tea actually was drunk in India more because of distribution and less about need scope and needs and wants and desires. That's what really happened with tea. I worked on the category for a number of years, that's what we recognized. Accessibility, very important. For example, in our industry, can we go and sell cell phones everywhere? No. If the operator hasn't put up a tower, there's no signals, we can't go there. So many times you have this accessibility issue. The most basic of accessibility is infrastructure. Power. Can you sell television if there's no access to power? Almost certainly no. Almost certainly. So accessibility is a very important issue, and that has more to do with the ecosystem and what the ecosystem can offer. On your own, can you go and do something? Except food, biscuits. You can go and do something on your own. Most of the categories need somebody else. Third is affordability. When we are driving penetration, our challenge always was to get consumers at a value point. The rural consumer specifically does not have a cash problem. He has a cash flow problem. 50% of his income comes in April, May, June. 50% of his income. How do you catch that? And that's the reason why you have high credit in rural. Because I'm a consumer, I don't have money for the other 9 months. So what do? I go to the retailer and I pop whatever I have and take credit from. So the rural consumer has what we call a cash flow problem, and that's what we try to manage. So when you make things affordable, in a 1 rupee pack, in a 2 rupee pack, or whatever it is, what are you doing? You are ensuring that the consumers can tap into the category of organized brands. That's what you do. We've seen this repeatedly. We saw two big spurs. In 1984, television opened up in this country. In 85, 86, 87, every consumer market grew. Because suddenly, all the people who in India at that point of time had significantly less literacy, we were audio visual literate. So people would remember the chendu, people would remember the brand name, and go and play it out in their shops. The next boom we had was 93-94. That's what really happened. So value and getting people into the category through price points was critical. Any idea who started the concept of low price packs?
Cheap. cabin care.
No, that's shampoo, you're looking at shampoo. Overall as a concept. It was the tea companies in the 1950s, they used to sell a 3 paisa pack and a 5 paisa pack. That's where it started. And you said, Chick, the reason sachets became big in this country was the Southeast Asian crisis of the 1980s. In 1983, 84, 85, a lot of the Southeast Asian markets had an economic crisis. Colgate was the one who started. Colgate in Thailand and Indonesia, their business was collapsing because all they had was big bottles of shampoo and big tubes of toothpaste. And when the economic crisis hit them, a lot of the consumers didn't have money. So Colgate went and tested the concept of the sachet. A small toothpaste tube, a small sachet. When they checked it, they went into two concepts. One was, times are tough, you're poor, please buy this. And the second concept was, this is a fun way of consuming this category. These are the two concepts they put before the consumer. Which do you think won? How many think the first one won? Second one. You're all good marketers. Exactly what happened. Why is that? Because when you're poor, you don't like to be reminded you're poor. It's a very fundamental truism. You never like to be reminded. But many times people forget these lessons. Because you approach it with the most logical argument. And what people wanted was to tap into the category in a fun way so that they could actually forget their bad times. Indian movies are a great example. Escapism. It's exactly what it is. Exactly what it is. And that's how sachets came. So that concept then came into India and many people did it. And Chick being one of them. The next thing you need to think about is distribution. That was in terms of strategic terms. The next thing you need to think about is an execution. We've done strategy, now think of execution. In execution, you need to think of three things. Data. Data is scarce in the distribution world. The more data you collect, the more you analyze it, the better you will be, whether you're a sales manager or a brand manager or a marketing manager. I cannot tell you how important this is. The variance in outlets, what sells in an outlet, which model sells, why does it sell, understand. Data is at a premium in this country. We are not that organized as the American market or the European market. Try and drill into the data. First thing. Second is display. It is an absolute fact that in many categories, 30-40% of the decisions regarding a brand are taken in the outlet. That's where they're taken. Sitting in the shop, and the consumer goes to the shop. So, your ability to be present there and screen. What is the display? Most marketing and sales people will tell you it's a silent salesman. A display says, if I'm a display of Nescafe, it says, hey, I'm a coffee, my brand name is Nescafe, please come and buy me. So, somebody sees the advertising of Nescafe on television, somebody sees the hoarding of Nescafe on the road, somebody comes into the shop, sees Nescafe, goes back. So, being visible is absolutely critical. Now there's a science to it. Not all colors are visible. The best color combinations are red, white, yellow, black, etc. So if you look at the big brands globally, they're all in red, yellow, black, white. Think about it. All the cigarette brands. Think about Coca-Cola. Think about Eastman Kodak. There's the reasons. Those wavelengths are the best, scientifically, for somebody to pick it up. So there's a lot of science in the reason why brands have certain packaging colors. That's the reason. They are easily the most picked out on the shelf. The third is demonstration. Many categories require demonstration. I cannot tell you how many. Many, many require demonstration. How do you buy a bulb? What does the guy do when you buy a bulb? Texas. What is it? It's demonstration. So in many categories, you need somebody to demonstrate to you that it works. When you buy a durable, what does he do? He plugs it and shows it to you that it works. So if your category requires demonstration, please ensure that your salesperson and everybody around there has adequate knowledge of your category and your brand. There are many categories which require demonstration. Yeah? There are some categories which require sensory demonstration. Shampoo is a very good example. What do you do when you buy a bottle of shampoo? What's the first thing you do? In the shop.
Smell it.
Absolutely right, you smell it. So standing in the shop, you open the lid, smell it, put it back. So that's one form of demonstration from a brand. So think of many forms of demonstration. A.G. Lapley says this, right? This is not what I say, A.G. Lapley. He says there are three moments of truth in consumer products. They are consumer products, not enough. There are three moments of truth. The first moment of truth is when the consumer sees you are advertising. Does he or she like it? Is he predisposed to it? The second moment of truth is when the consumer is in the shop. And the third moment of truth is when the consumer opens it and starts consuming it at home. That's what he calls the three moments of truth. Okay, so think of that when you're doing this. Next slide. I talked of consumer drivers. What are the things which drive consumers in this country today? If you look at urban India, specifically people such as yourself, the first driver is aspiration. Almost every category has a huge aspirational value in this country. Every category. Second is quality. People have aspiration, but they are unwilling to buy poor quality. And the third driver is price. However rich the person, however well to do the person, a person always wants a bargain. Always is looking for a deal. That's what he's doing. So aspiration, quality, price. Those are the three drivers for urban India. In rural India, it's the same three drivers, but in a different way. The first is price. The second is aspiration. The third is quality. That's how they work. So these are the drivers. And why are these drivers important? Think of your distribution strategy. Think of what's happening in the channel. What are you building of these three drivers in the channel? That's what you should really look at. So for example, when somebody goes to an outlet, does it look wow? Does it make you feel excited? That's what aspiration is. If your outlet is gaudy and you're trying to sell very good brand and merchandise, you won't sell. That's what aspiration is. So aspiration is just not about the brand, it's also about the place I shop. That's what you should look at. If the consumer is looking for value, are you signaling price? When consumers walk into outlets, large outlets, not the Kirana outlets, when they walk into outlets, what's the first question they ask the salesperson? Any idea? What's the first question? Two-thirds of consumers ask that question globally, not just in India. What's the question? The question they ask is, what's the price? You know why they ask what's the price? They are overwhelmed. They don't know. That's their conversation starter. They go look at something, they say, hey, what's the price of this? Because they're trying to engage you to start a conversation. That is what you really need to understand. They're not. But what happens to most companies and sales managers, they take that as the consumer is interested only in price, which is a big mistake. The consumer is asking you that question to start a conversation. You know, it's like if a girl goes and asks the boy, what's your name? Yeah, she's trying to find out what his name is. She's not trying to tell him she's in love with him, right? That's exactly the situation. If somebody asks you what's the price, you know, they're starting a conversation. Find out what that person is. Don't take out the message that it's all about price. So price, aspiration, quality. So think through your distribution and especially what you do in outlets around that. So when you talk of distribution, there are three people involved. There is a manufacturer, there is a consumer, there is a retailer. This is what I call the eternal triangle. Only two people will be happy in this equation at any point in time. Three people cannot be, you know, that state cannot be reached, you know, whether in physics or in any state, it cannot be reached. So let's look at the manufacturer retailer. The first thing they always have a confrontation is about margins. The retailer wants more and more margins. If the manufacturer gives the retailer more margin, he makes less money. So there's a certain sum of margin. The retailers are always saying, give me more. That's the first challenge. Second, the manufacturer always sees the retailer as a necessary evil. I have to have him because I need to serve the consumer. If I had my choice, I will not deal with it. Third, the retailer many times, especially in Western markets, and it's happening in India with the Kishobia name, they go to the manufacturer and say, fine, you sell me Cadbury's chocolate, you sell me Nescafe coffee, you also make a private label for me. Please make a product in my brand name and give it to me at half the price. In Germany, private label is 68 cents. So it's the same manufacturer who makes a different brand for the retailer, gives it back to them. So that's the next big challenge. And fourth challenge between retailer and manufacturer is supply chain management. Because a lot of money is locked up in inventory. Which is the most celebrated example of a manufacturer and retailer working together to train supply chain? Absolutely right. Full marks. Procter and Walmart. Okay, so David Glass and Edwards, when they went on a rowing trip or whatever it was, they looked at the two inventories and said, this is unviable. And what they said was, if we had 100 rupees locked up, how much can we release? If we release 20 rupees of this inventory, let's share it half-half. So what really happens now, when a Walmart store sells a Pampers, automatically the link goes up to the information system, and Procter & Gamble factory knows that a box of Pampers has been sold. And in the next 24 hours, it's on the truck back to the outlet. So they really cut out complete excess inventory. So this is what is the relation between manufacturer and retailer. Let's look at the next one, retailer and the consumer. First, this is one of trust. Why? That's because the retailer is the neighborhood retailer. You go to him every day, your mother goes to him every day, your sister goes to him every day, your brother goes to him every day. That's right. There's familiarity. So if anything, you pick up the phone, just walk across. All of you walk across from the gate to the outlet there. You trust the guy, he trusts you. So go on. Second, what does the retailer give the consumer? Experience. Whatever that is. Experience in the outlet. That's what he's supposed to provide. Third, he provides convenience. In the middle of the night, you don't have milk, or 10 o'clock, you don't have milk. You call the neighborhood grocer, he delivers milk at your grocer in India. That's convenience. You have a headache, you want to close in, you call the chemist, he delivers it. That's what retailers do, convenience. And fourth, the retailer has a database of his consumers. He tries to build it and hold on to it. That's how he ensures that he monetizes his consumer base in a better manner. Some people do it with science, some people do not do it with science. So that's the equation between the retailer and the consumer. If you look at the manufacturer and the consumer, the first thing is the brand. If you don't have a brand, which is a strong enough brand, then the manufacturer is hijacked by the retailer. So it's in the manufacturer's interest all the time to build a strong brand. When you have a strong brand, you can give less retail margin. When you have a weak brand, you need to give more retail margin and more schemes or more trade discounts in order to keep your brand. So building a brand and building that perception in the consumer's mind actually helps you in terms of your negotiation with retail. Second, advertising. You create a perception of your company and everything through advertising after having a brand. Third is the signal value. This pack, this price, this ingredient, whatever it is, the signal value. And fourth is, the manufacturer always has data about the consumer from a segmentation point of view. The retailer has data on the consumer from a database point of view. If you are able to fuse these two together, then you create magic. So I understand consumers in the way they behave about the category. The retailer understands consumers from the way they behave with their money vis-a-vis the category. If I can combine those two very well, then I create magic. But quite often, the retailer is unwilling to give this database, and the manufacturer is unwilling to share the segmentation. And that's why successful retailers and successful companies sit together to try and do this. We have an outlet chain called University in South India. Okay, a smart young guy, working with a couple of self-made man to set up. One of the things we try to do with him is exactly this. We try to take his data, we put our category segmentation data with him, and then develop proposition so that he can upgrade his consumers much faster. That's where the value lies. Next. What are the concepts to think about? First, think of control. In distribution, you always need to worry about control. Okay? Control can come in many dimensions. Control can be at one level. Take luxury brands. All luxury brands. Louis Vuitton, Hugo Boss, Armani, Tommy Hilfiger, any of these guys, Gucci, Ferragamo. If you go to their outlet, the control they want is the look and feel of the brand. The shop is the advertising and luxury goods. Remember that. They don't advertise. The shop is the advertising. So you need to control it so that wherever you go in the world, It has the same look and feel. That's what it is. So the control of the look and feel of the brand in luxury is that. Second, control in terms of pricing. You want control of pricing in the channel. You do not want people to undercut you. You do not want people to, you know, create absolute chaos in the marketplace. That's another reason why you want control. And third reason why you want control is information. Those are the three reasons why you think of the concept for control and distribution. Second, channel conflict. When you use many channels, I talked to you about many different ways of going from the producer to the consumer. When you use multiple channels, you will have conflict. You'll have channel conflict. You'll have people crisscrossing each other and trying to do all the wrong things. How do you manage that? What's your policy regarding that? Same thing, multiple channels, multiple business models. For example, your generation will find, you will say, I go to the big bazaar, I go to somewhere, the price of this product is 20, let's say 2,000 rupees. But I go on the net, I get it for 1,500. The business model on the net is cheaper than the physical business model. So you ask yourself, why should I pay in the physical world? So that is a business model conflict. How do you manage that? Third is physical and digital brands distribution. In the physical world, you cannot afford a long tail. Retailers cannot keep it, distributors cannot keep it, you cannot sell a lot of SKUs. But in the digital world works only if you have a long tail. Because people on the net are far more niche than people in the physical world. So in the digital world, you need to offer a really long tail. Let's take books. If you go to the best bookshop in Park Street, you will get maybe 1,000 titles. That's fine, you were there. But if you go to Amazon.com, you would expect 1 million titles. That's the difference I'm talking about. In a physical world on Park Street, can you stock 1 million books? No chance. So depending on which business model you're following, or maybe both, you need to think of the long tail. Cost versus reach. India has 600,000 villages, just like Group 1 and Lipton did. You can cover all 600,000 of them with one salesman each, 620,000. What's the cost of that among us? So you need to always judge, how much cost do I need to incur in distribution to get the optimum reach? So I use a combination of a wholesaler, I use the combination of a town stockist, whatever it is. All distribution is cost versus reach. You need to balance that. There's no free lunch. Next, push versus pull. There are some companies who have an intrinsic philosophy that I will advertise over the air and I will bring consumers into the shop. That's a typical Procter & Gamble philosophy. So when Procter & Gamble took over Gillette, what happened? There was a clash of cultures. Gillette was a push culture. The Gillette trading terms in this country were so many days credit, so much stock in the outlet, etc. That doesn't work in the Procter philosophy. So today, P&G runs two separate streams of trading terms for Procter brands and Gillette brands. So if your company has a push strategy, it's a very different way you work compared to when your company has a pull strategy. You need to manage that. And that's the next question. Finally, is rural a simple thing? If not, many people, you know, think rural is an easy game. And almost everybody thinks he or she should go to, you know, rural and do it. That's not really true. What are the products which have had good rural distribution efforts in the past? Any idea? Okay, what? Nawal, what?
Nirma.
What? Somebody say
now.
Everyday, absolutely. So let's stick with that. That's what I was looking for. Let's stick with Everyday and batteries. Why did batteries develop rural distribution, and why did they go to villages to sell the batteries? Most logical explanation, right? That's one part, right? Next. Yeah, fine. Agreed, logical explanation, correct. Next. Any other reason?
Power short.
Faster? No? Power, we already talked about. Okay, now let's go back. Let's go back to the 60s. This concept started in the 60s, where Everyday went into the smallest of villages to distribute their batteries on the back of a van. What was the structure of batteries in the 60s? What was the cover of the battery? It was metal. It was not paper. It was metal. So if you have metal covered batteries, the jacket is metal, what happens to the weight of the box? Very heavy. So now ask yourself, if you look at any distribution box in the wholesale market for any category, it does not cross more than 14.4 kg. That's the reason for it. The reason being, that's what a man can carry back on his shoulder. So here you have a very heavy category. How can you distribute it? People are unwilling to carry it. So that's why, in order to overcome the weight situation, they had to set up their own distribution going into the smallest of villages in a land. That's what they did. They had to overcome the weight of their cattle. So that's one example. Why people? Somebody said cigarettes. But cigarettes is not the biggest distributor. There is, somebody said, BDs. Who said that BDs? BDs, absolutely right. BDs is like batteries. So why did the BD guys go and distribute on their own? Use the battery analogy as an example. What do you think drove them to do it? It's bulk. If somebody buys 1,000 rupees of BDs, it's a huge sack. How many sacks can you carry? So battery was weight, BD was bulk. So they had no choice but to put out their vans and go into the smallest of villages and sell it, because they had to carry bulk. People couldn't carry it from there. That's the second example. Third, I mentioned that not every category can go into rural India and sell. Mother of Courts, you know, understood this to their written. What does Mother of Courts sell? They sell threads. That's what they sell, threads. So they went and told the consumer, okay, now we make zips. So then you had Mother of Courts zips also with the tailors. It didn't work. Why didn't it work? Any reason? Went and covered rural, it didn't work. Go back to, I talked of accessibility and the ecosystem. If you are a tailor, what all will you buy? What all do you need? You need zips, you need folds, you need collars, you need everything. Madura garments only offers two of them. For everything else, the tailor has to go to the nearest town. So he turned back and told Madura garments, what's the use of just two? I might as well go to the nearest town and buy everything. So that's why Madura garments really didn't go down the rural path. Exactly what this is. They didn't have a complementarity of products. In India, in FMCG, I was saying this at the Godrej board meeting 2 weeks ago, you need either a strong detergent brand or you need a strong soap brand if you need to penetrate a lot of things. Because these are the two categories which have 90% penetration. So if you have a strong carrier brand, which is a very big detergent brand, EG Nirma, EG V, or a big soap brand, EG Godrej number 1, EG Lifebuoy, then everything else can go behind. If you don't have one of these two, you cannot really go all the way. You will go somewhere like Colgate does. You will go somewhere like Procter does. But you need a very strong mass detergent brand or soap brand in order to be big. That's the fundamental lesson from the Indian market for FMCG. So when all of the companies look for distributors in small towns, they invariably ask, who is the Hindustan Unilever stockist? Let's go right on to it. Next section is the Nokia section. How does Nokia do its work? For the north and east, we sell through HCL, which is our national distributor. And west and south, we have our own stockist. Under that, we have micro distributors in small towns and rural areas. We have different ways of reaching the consumer. The first is Nokia Priority Dealers, which is a franchise combination which consumers go to. The second is independent telecom outlets, the mom and pop equivalent. The third is operator outlets. We currently sell from 20 of, let's say, Vodafone stores and others. Next is consumer electronic outlets. These are the big box players. Then is others. Then is organized trade. So these are the different channels. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So we have virtually 6 business models running on it, 6 different trade terms, and we try and manage that. What's the philosophy? Our philosophy is keep it open, open distribution, balanced urban channel landscape, and increase reach in rural India. That's because rural India is moving from about 20% penetration to about 40-50 in the next few years. Our retail structure, at the top is the Nokia branded retail, what we call MBR. The next is the solutions provider, where you have the laptop and wireless all geared up, and we try to teach people how to, you know, do stuff. Then we have other promoter outlets, and then general retail. What differentiates them is the value they deliver, the terms, and the stamp control. What are the challenges? First challenge, we cannot go and distribute on our own. If the operator network is not there, we cannot go there. So our first challenge is the railroad must be there for us. The railroad is the operator network. Once the operator puts up his network, we can go on the railroad. So that's our first challenge. Second is trade awareness and training. A lot of you understand intrinsically what red and green buttons mean on the phone. To a lot of rural people who have never seen any traffic lights, they do not understand what red and green means. You have to educate the trade, who needs to educate them. So for a lot of product categories like this, it's a digital product. This is not another soap, this is not another shampoo, this is not another biscuit. People have a mental frame of what to do in those categories. In this category, we teach the consumer via the trade. The more we educate the trade, the more he will educate the consumer. It's in our interest to educate the consumer. Third, we have a high number of SKUs. We launch 40 models a year, one every week. A successful model in our business lasts 18 months, 18 to 24 months. An unsuccessful model lasts 6 days. So how do you manage that in a large distribution chain? That's a big challenge. Fourth, price range. We have the biggest price stretch across all categories. Before this, I used to study cigarettes. Cigarettes used to have the highest price stretch. What do I mean by that? The lowest offering from a brand is 1 rupee. In cigarettes, the maximum from the same brand is 15 rupees. The stretch is 15 times. In Nokia, our cheapest phone is 1,500 rupees. Our costliest phone with the Nokia brand name is 35,000 rupees. We have a stretch of 30. So how do you manage that stretch? In terms of which outlets and what is stock. So that's the big challenge. Next, shorter life cycle, I described that. Price protection. We see price dropping every week or every month. So when trade buys this, we need to compensate them if price drops. How do you have an information mechanism so that you can handle it? Next, dead on arrival. There are some products which are dead on arrival. It happens in all electronic products. What's the policy regarding that and how do you take it back? Next is grey imports. Because this is a product which takes just $1 to transport from Europe to here, you'll find all kinds of products coming in and going out. What is the Nokia liability if somebody buys a Nokia phone from Europe to the smuggled market? Channel market, the obvious one. And most important of all, we have the biggest distribution network for any digital product or brand in this country. In rural India, when people buy a digital brand, the first question they ask is, what do I do if this goes wrong? So many times, your service network has to be there in tandem with your sales network. Because that's a huge value creation. If your service network is not there, people don't buy you. They just give up. So in all electronic products, in all digital categories, your ability to have an after-sales service network, which is omnipresent, is very important. There's one company which advertises that very well, which is not a digital product. What is that? Maruti, absolutely. Maruti is a very good example of understanding the concept. Of saying there's an after-sales service point very close to wherever you are. In that sense, you create more value and consumers are reassured. In marketing terms, a lot of this is what, you know, professors and books call cognitive dissonance. How do you reduce the cognitive dissonance? That's what it is. What are the new models we're trying? We try things for reverse bundling with the operator. We're doing a lot of stuff on vans with them. And we try alternate distribution channels. What's reverse bundling? Basically what it is, the operator gives the SIM card to our distributor. Our distributor combines the two and sells it on the marketplace as one bundle. That's what it is. In most Western markets, what happens is, we sell the handset to the operator, he bundles it and sells it forward. In India, we do exactly the opposite. Okay, this is a model which is only Indian. We are now exporting it into Africa, we are now exporting it into Southeast Asia and some markets like that. We do a lot of work with all the big operators in terms of rural vans, because remember, if they put their network and Nokia handsets don't go there, they don't get it. You get it? We go with our handsets, the operator doesn't put his network, we don't get it. So both of us work hand in hand, because, you know, we are in a sense tied at the hip. We need each other. So we run a three-legged race into rural India. We run this race with all the operators. We work closely with Airtel, we work closely with Idea, we work closely with Vodafone, all of them do this. Alternate business models. We have a tie-up with TIPCO and we have a tie-up with the microfinance company, SKS. What SKS does is it gives loans to women for income generating activities. They don't do it for men, it's only for women. And when we went and asked women, do they buy a mobile phone, they said, do I really need one? And when we actually dug deep, we found the reason they didn't buy one was they didn't want to shell out that 1,500 rupees or 2,000 rupees. They said, the husband has one, why do I need one? If you look at rural population, 700 million people, 340 or 350 is women. Okay. If you're not going to have a proposition for them, we're not going to go to this time. So we sat down with women and asked them, what's the real reason? They said, if you can offer to me a weekly payment or a monthly payment, then I'm willing to buy this. So today, we work with SKS in 10 states, where a rural woman pays 70 rupees a week, and over 26 weeks, she owns a mobile. So how have we done this? It's us, it's Airtel. Airtel offers them a special SIM card, special deal, and there's SKS Microfinance which gives them the money. So go back to affordability, accessibility. Remember that first three words? That's exactly what we're trying. Wherever we've tried this experiment, and Navendu, who is our RGM of the East, pioneered this when he was in head office, we see a 30% jump in penetration amongst women as a result of doing this. What does it do? It locks in the consumer with us and Airtel and SKS. So that's something which we're doing. I personally believe it will be a big one in order to get women into mobility in the future. What does the future mean? We are moving from being a device brand to more solutions and services. So as I mentioned, I talked about consumption. This is going to be education. This is going to be a lot more to do with what a consumer can do with this mobile tomorrow. Today, it has voice with it. So we are saying, what more can you do with it? That's what we're really pushing. We're pushing the frontiers of that. We personally believe a future world. Today, when a consumer leaves a home, he takes his mobile phone, he takes his wallet, and he takes his keys with him. We believe in the future, when he goes out of his house, he'll require only one thing, which is a mobile phone. He will not need his wallet, he will not need his keys. The mobile phone should have enough functionality and enough technology to do all things. That's our view of the future. That's what we will. So in terms of my last slide, and I'm exactly on the dot, an hour, India distribution is a challenge. It's a big challenge. It's not for the faint hearted. A lot of people who look at it from the outside don't understand. Don't understand it at all. Okay. Don't be glib about it. Get into the details of it. It's a huge penetration game. It's also a huge consumption challenge. Both are important. Some categories, consumption is more important, and some categories, penetration is critical. There are different distribution models. Distribution is all the activities from producer to consumer. And we discussed how you can reach them. The consumer, the retailer, and the manufacturer. The holy trinity. At this point of time, only two can be happy in the triangle. Not all three can ever be happy. There's a reason why the manufacturer exists. There's a reason why the retailer exists. And there's a reason why the consumer parts with his hard-earned money to the retailer, who then passes it on to the manufacturer. And we discussed the concept to think about, whether it was control. I talked about luxury brands wanting to control, etc. Push versus pull, and those kind of examples. So the end of 1 hour, that's all I have to say. Thank you very much for the invitation, Professor Ryan Mazumdar. Now, I'm open to any questions, any thoughts, any comments. An open distribution system is, thank you for asking the question, where from a telecom ecosystem point of view, the consumer will go and buy the SIM card separately, he'll buy the handphone separately. In Western markets, the operator, who is the owner of the SIM card, controls the handset. That is a closed distribution network. An open distribution network is where you make two choices of brands, operator and consumer, operator and the handset. So what an open distribution system means is only strong brands, either in the handset space or in the operator space, can really make an effective bundle. You cannot have it. So if I were to... So if I were to just put it conceptually for you in a simple matrix, if you take operator, you take handset. You take a strong operator brand, you take a weak operator brand. You take a strong handset brand, you take a weak handset brand. So strong operator brand, strong handset brand would be an Airtel plus Nokia, a Vodafone plus Nokia. Quite often operators make this mistake. They think they are strong, they can pull a weak handset brand along with them. Never works. Vodafone tried pulling a weak handset brand called Sejum for a number of months in Gujarat. It doesn't work at all. And that is what we mean by open distribution. Open distribution really allows us to be innovative and really get the best for our users. That's why we are proponents of the open distribution. Before I said that VK thing, I said SKS gives loans for what? I said a very important thing, three words. Income generating activity. So I didn't explain what that income generating activity was. 29% of the SKS microfinance loans are for buffaloes. A buffalo gives 4 liters of milk a day, that's 18 rupees a day. The second biggest income generating activity the microfinance company lends to is retail. So set up a vegetable shop or a retail outlet, that's another 30%. So that is where the income comes, by which they pay for the taxes.
Premium consumers with their card owners. Then they came to Nokia and said,
can we do this experiment only in Nokia? So we do this only in 8 Nokia. It's an experiment we've been running for the last 2 months. So we bought 3,000 handsets and did it. Immensely successful. Has it changed behavior? Yes. The number of times a consumer is now using this mobile phone as a credit card is higher than the number of times the consumer was using this plastic as the card. It's changed behavior. So it's good for them, it's generated more business. Is it scalable? I don't know. That's what we need to work on. Because for 3,000 consumers, Citibank was willing to subsidize and do something. If you talk of 100 million consumers or 35 million credit card holders in this country, is it scalable? We'll have to work. So that's what we call the app and paper.
We talked about Nokia transforming into a services company. Couple of days ago, I was reading about Nokia Life Tools. So could you just throw some light on the vision?
Nokia Life Tools is something we started from India. We set up a group. We started this 3 years ago, along with BCG, to study what the needs of consumers were in Africa, India, China, and Southeast Asia. Why? In all these markets, a phone was just not a phone for people, it was a smartphone. People were looking at it in many more ways. They were asking us, why can't I do more with the phone? Can you do something with this? So we looked at the broad areas they were interested in. They were interested in agriculture information. They were interested in education. They were interested in health. They were interested in payments. And then they were interested in entertainment. Those were the five big blocks they were interested in. When we looked at that, we said, which are the areas where we will not enter into a conflict with the government or regulatory bodies? Health requires a very different regulatory mechanism. Payment requires a very different regulatory mechanism. So we said, let's keep those two aside. Let's do agriculture information, education, and entertainment. So what do we do in agriculture? We tie up with a lot of people to get information on the mandi rates of the crop within 100 kilometers of where the farmer lives. He gets the rates of all the mandis, of the mandis in that area. He gets the crop price and says, this is the selling rate, now we can sell it for low needs. When we started this, interesting, going back to rational argument, the price of the service was 60 rupees a month. Okay. So when this was proposed in the meeting, everybody said, including myself, said this won't work. Okay. Why did we say it won't work? We compared it with the average revenue the consumer was spending on a mobile phone or a SIM card today in rural India was 100 rupees. So we said, he's spending 100 rupees on this thing called mobile phone, 60 rupees for a month, forget it. So we went back to the service line and said, look, we need a better price. They looked at all the prices and said, forget it. We cannot. This is bare minimum and this is how we make money. So we said, okay, let's try. So we went and tried an experiment in West of Maharashtra. And that's when our eyes opened. 10 of us went there, including myself. We went to the farmer and we asked the farmer a simple question. We'd like to stop this from tomorrow. And that's what's in the marketing terms called deprivation study. You take away something he has, how does he feel? If he's really attached to it, he'll object, he'll scream, he'll shout at you. So when we said we take it off tomorrow, he said, no, I don't want you to take it off. This is great for me. So I asked him why. He said, today, before I got this Nokia Life Tools, proper information, I had to take my mobile car out to go to the nearest mandi, or I had to make a phone call, or I had to subscribe to a newspaper which was 2 rupees a day. He was spending 30 rupees a day to get that information. And they were giving him for 2 rupees a day. So he said, this is fantastic. That's when we realize, in a country like India, there is value in information operation. That is the first service we offer. The second service we offer is education, which is you learn English one word at a time. The word is pushed to you on your phone by an SMS phonetically. It also tells you how to construct sentences with that word. And should you care to take a test after 6 to 7 days, it will also help you with that test. Now we are offering many more things in terms of exams and all that stuff. Why is that important? If you go to rural India, 60% of the rural youth do not want to be farmers. They don't want to be farmers. One way it is sad. They believe learning the English language is their passport to the formal economy, which is the services job. That's the reason why they want it. So that's what they really attack. The third is entertainment, which is normal. So that's what Nokia Life Tools is. It comes at 60 rupees for agriculture, 30 rupees for education, and 30 rupees for.
First, I'll just say that I've only owned three phones in my life, and they're all Nokia's. But I don't know about that, but I was surprised when I saw your list of challenges that one was missing, and that's addressing yields, especially because you had a shortened product life cycle. So I'm wondering how UX is going to be seen as a business opportunity within an environmental problem if you employ a reverse logistics system that uses take-back programs and recycling to generate profits and